Yeah, I got four more, but
started you read it in my creation. I'm Kai Zodiac, I'm made from constellations. My brain is a bomb waiting to flame an abomination. No change in the bomber's nation, just some more dollars placed in the pockets of Satan. While I walk amongst the blind, explain chakras to the cavemen. I'm locking from the grave, sending doctors to the shamans. Scientists ashamed, they getting knowledge from the pagans. I'm in Nirvana with militant, philosophical, diligent builders aiming for spots in a large nation. I'm in the all in all, the cream of God hopped and rise to the occasion. Surprised that we invading your time's finished, diminished. I'm live from the awakening. Cameras on tilt as I flex my success. I'm fly, look what I built. Smooth just like silk in the groove. You might wilt if your lotus ain't focused. It's on just like a quilt from the needle to the record to the laser. My behavior resembles the high savior. See my two fingers up, yelling peace to the gods. Waving by to the haters, standing on the black dot in the center of my square. In the middle of the circle, I designed the creator. Khalifa the Khalifa, when I speak through the speaker. Thoughts of a magician is lost in mysticism that reached the non-believer. I shine in your theater.
The clock was already moving before you.
I-A-K, send it to MC for the record. Each song is the part that makes me. Signs of the time, the future I foresee. K-A-Z-O-D. I-A-K, send it to MC for the record. Each song is the part that makes me. Wheel of the spirit, the stars, deities. Who's better than this? Intelligentness. Clouds like I pass heaven to split. Killing cops, shame your treacherousness. You serve the devil, you're protecting the myth. Professional hitman, I spit excellence. I connect you to bliss. Grab this pebble from my hand and I let you resist. But if you don't, well, I spit a ghost spell. Get off my coattails. My coach is I God. I live it so well. The life of a G is high as can be. A soul model, what your role model aspires to be. True boss life. In order to lead, you need foresight. We can't risk the PRT. We ain't poor, right? Ever. The rich righteous that fix the crisis of the terror of the mid-lifeless. The myth virus infecting the whole planet, infected the globe is medic depressing. My soul answers the questions. I'm like Osiris flying in the gold plated sky disc with no pilot. Kingdom of heaven, you can walk through my gate but speak certainty. Silence is a virtuous trait. I was more amazing. I ain't have to learn to be great. When every child's born, they ain't have to learn to create. It's when it feels rejected, that's when love turns into hate. God leaped through a hole within space. Welcome to my dimension. When you think of the God, well, I'm the guy you mentioned. A-Z-O-D-I-A-K, you send it to MC for the record. Each song is the part that makes me. Signs of the time, the future I foresee. K-A-Z-O-D-I-A-K, you send it to MC for the record. Each song is the part that makes me. Wheel of the spirit, the star, wheel of the spirit, the star, wheel of the spirit, the star, wheel of the spirit, the star.
You're not ready for that, right?
Wheel of the spirit, the star, wheel of the spirit, the star,
the dynamic of all is in that wheel. And discover that you live. You just ain't ready to take on that dimension.
We just really regurgitate
what the creators already know.
Jay Black, straight like that.
Yeah. And Bill had to set it up right. Peace to Kazo the Gag. Okay, all praise the start of Jesus. Salute to Jay Black on the execution. Okay. Executed properly. So we're here to celebrate. We're here to honor. We're here to analyze. And I got one of the greatest minds. He's one of the greatest storytellers and one of the greatest question askers at the same damn time. Okay. And a reminder that hip hop is not a monolith, nor is music. So the music genre, alterator, the party motivator, one time in the place to be, he goes by the name of Young Hump MC. One time in the place to be, he goes by the name of Young Hump MC. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together and show your love and welcome back to the platform. One more, yeah. Young Hump, one half of the epic digital underground. Let's stop what you're doing because I'm about to ruin the image of the style that you used to. Peace to the God.
You look you look amazing. Peace, God. What's up, King?
Hey. Gather around. Up, I'm the new fool in town, and my style's laid down by the underground.
Talk about it. Yeah, so we just I'm in the Uber coming back from Pechanga. You know, I was out there, man. You know, Carlito has his ways and shit, but you know, I fucks with Pechanga, man. It's my nigga. Even though he was treacherous, that's still my nigga. So we went out to his casino out there in Temecula, you know, Pechanga Casino or whatever. We did a show. It was us. It was with the big bros. So it's Digital Underground. Of course, we had a homies tag team, you know, DC Magic the Brain. And we have motherfucking CNC Music Factory, Freedom Allah, you know what I mean? The God Freedom. Yo, a lot of y'all need to know about Freedom's Degrees. That's a real brother right there. Of course, Smooth Jammy in the building. Of course, we also have the one, the motherfucking only Tone Loke, the old
Spunky Cole Medina Loke.
G Tonsa, aka the lowest. Yo, we back. Okay. You hear me?
Yes.
Did I spin out for a second? Okay.
Yes.
Tone Loke. I said my guy Tone Loke with the man, the God, man. He know about a party like him. And then of course we also had the one and only, the masters, the architects, the Sugar Hill Gang was in the building. You know what I mean? There's nothing now like tapping in with my uncle.
Here is not a test. I'm rapping to the beat.
Let me tell you something. My man Master G. G is like, he might be the best dressed gentleman in all of hip hop. You could tell Pharrell that. You could tell Dapper Dan's most eager client that they ain't seeing Master G. But yo, and on one more thing just to add to this, for our set, we brought special guests with us. We had the one and only Razzcast, you know what I mean?
Razzcastiano.
Come on. And then we had Hutch, aka the cool 187 from Above the Law in the building. He performed Black Superman. I had a fantasy. I got to be on stage and do ad-libs for my mama. I'm her real Black Superman. Woo! Yes. So it was fun time last night.
Willie Hutch nephew. Okay.
That part.
Yes. And shout out to Master G, my Gemini brother. You understand what I'm saying? The older brother of the coolest guy that was ever in a movie. The young OG, okay? My man who played Richie in The Last Dragon is his younger brother. That's why he was so damn fly and so damn grown young.
That's okay? Best.
Gotcha.
Yo, you know what's so crazy? As soon as you say that, they have that same facial features. Wow, that's big. That's crazy. Wow. I always wondered what's up with the guy. He was so, my man Pop locked out of the ropes. That was the best shit ever.
Yes.
That was the best shit ever.
He infused the hip hop into the kung fu. Shout out to Berry Gordy, the greatest to ever do it. Right there.
Come on. And shout out to Vanity.
Woo.
God.
Lord have mercy.
Let me put the V over me. Hold on.
Yeah, the V. And so we're here talking about epic movies. Epic movies. Today's a movie day.
Yes.
Today's a movie day, mate. Talk to him, guy.
This day, 30 years ago, Above the Rim came out. Above the Rim came out the day before today, 30 years ago, yesterday. The Above the Rim soundtrack came out, and it changed my life forever, okay? It changed my life forever. I thought Murder Was the Case was the one that changed my life forever. I thought The Chronic had changed my life forever. I thought Doggy Style had changed my life forever. Above the Rim soundtrack changed my life forever. You understand?
Go ahead.
This is a West Coast moment. I need every bit of the moment of the sights and the sounds 30 years ago.
And you notice I got the color. I'm looking like the tape myself with the color on. I'm looking like the color of the tape. Yes. I was gonna say, yo, when we first heard that, boom, we were like, oh really? We're like, okay, it was over. It's never been. There's never been a better moment. Tell the youngsters, I don't give a fuck what they feeling, whatever. There's never been a moment that was better than when that shit dropped, and when your man Nate said, "I was at the park one day."
That's when I saw her face. You look at oh.
See, that man. Was when a nigga could. That was when brothers still could connect the old school like doo-wop, sitting in the park waiting for you. Like you could connect that energy to the G-Funk and bring it in. And because the thing is like, I don't always want to hear motherfuckers talk about how many bullets they have and how much money they just wasted on something I don't want. It's so nice to hear somebody just say, I was in the park one day. Like, I can sing that with you. I don't need a Draco or a man purse. All I need is to be cognizant of where I was that day. So, yeah, that was the greatest. And then also, that was Daz
with his instrument, instrumentation voice. Like, I'm there, like, woke up one morning, I survived, man. My dick kind of limp, so I cruised around the block. Called my cousin, Snoop, I just pooped with it. Daz was floating.
Because see, Daz is one of the most underrated rappers. Because a lot of people don't really totally like. Because a lot of just coming back. The same way, like I was saying, Daz, people transfix on bars and punchlines, but they don't realize Daz could rock a beat like no other. And here's something I want to point out. Same way we will credit Andre 3000 for like kicking a rap about walking into a grocery store and somebody walks up to him and says they, you know, whatever, and he just like gives you this like a real slice of like an hour of his life or 2 hours of his life.
Right.
Daz was the master of like, he just basically told you like what he did. Just checked on my homie Lil C style, went over his crib, seen my nigga over there and damn near floating. He talked about seeing the homie so high off smoking them sticks, and like he just give you like a quick little like a real snapshot of a morning of Long Beach, because Daz is an early riser, as he loves to let us know. So it's a beautiful thing, man. That shit was like, you know, that shit is corrupt, ain't even on the song. Like, it's just it's. I mean, that's how LO was. I mean, as nasty as Corrupt was, it was like, yo, we do this. Like, Corrupt wasn't even here that day. This is just another song. Yeah, Corrupt wasn't on there. Right. Like, because every time you go back to that song, you're like, wow, Gotti ain't on that one. Right. But it's like, it was just natural. They was just in the pocket. It was just, they were just doing them. Right. Like, Gotti was probably in South Central that day, taking something down like he should.
Yes.
Yeah, that soundtrack. But
he already murdered. What would you do? Like, what else did he need to do at that time? You see what I'm saying? Like, and he murdered Doggy Dog World, right? Like, he had the epic. He had Stranded on Death Row. He had What Would You Do? He had Doggy Dog World. Like, he had some of the illest shit ever. Like, he was cool. He was like, look. And Daz didn't get a lot of credit because he was doing a lot of production too. So he was doing a bunch of production on top of
big facts. They wasn't ready for Daz. See, Daz is like when you eating Thanksgiving dinner, and like the rice and gravy is just making everything so complete, but you so focused on the other dishes and you talking about the mac and cheese and you talking about this and the cranberry and this, but you ain't really acknowledging that all of that is supported by the rice and gravy or whatever. Like, that's Daz is that. He's like, he really, Daz low-key is really low-key the real bedrock of Death Row. Like, if you really go there, Daz, if you really had to say out of all the artists who made Death Row, really, it's really Daz. Because if you really think about it, he did more production than Dre, and that's not a slight, but he was there longer, and he produced two-thirds of Doggy Style. It is what it is, right. You know what I mean, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we know Dre is the visionary and put it all together, but it's like Daz was the man that really, you know, the nuts and bolts, the glue, the foundation, the cement, the, like, you know, plus he's rapping on all that shit. Plus he, I mean, we can go on with that. Daz, don't get me started. I mean, Daz is like, I mean, come on, man, forget about it. And if you look at the Death Row greatest hits,
yes,
what didn't Daz? I mean, but anyways, so, but speaking of production, and just while we on the soundtrack to Above the Rim, speaking of, what's amazing is that classic song Pain, which was an interesting thing because it was on the tape, but it wasn't on the CD or something like that. But
right.
I was gonna say that was, speaking of production, produced by Big Stretch from Live Squad, rest in peace, who Wood Harris's character was patterned after, and he dressed like. So it's amazing, like, well, production, like,
yes, deep.
We're gonna get to Wood Harris. Deep. We ain't even got there yet.
Yeah, we ain't even got there yet. That Easter eggs right there.
Where you want to start? I know we could jump around or we could go right there. What you want to do? Because I got some things to share, but I want to let you leave, man. You know, I'm in your world.
I got one scene. You know, I'm good for a scene. I'm good for one scene that I think is the pinnacle scene that sets up everything else that happens. Protagonist / antagonist meet together on screen for the first time, and it's the greatest shit ever. One of the most memorable moments to me of the jump. Everything else gets built off of that.
Hello. Sorry, somebody called me. I had to shake the call. You talking about when Dwayne and Lassane?
Well, I'm gonna play the scene. You'll know the scene.
Oh, you gonna play the scene? Oh, we high tech now. Production value is very high. I love it. Let's go.
Yeah. So we're about to play the scene.
That's next level. I love it.
Finally made it back for the old lady's birthday, huh? How long you been on?
A couple weeks.
Why you didn't call me, man? I knew you'd be back. I knew you would. Your little brother done came up, man.
Really?
Hell yeah. I mean, shit got bad. Real bad. Up in that damn bodega with mama food stamps and motherfuckers be laughing at me. Can you believe that? I mean, they was laughing at me. We had no lights, no electricity, no food. We all wrapped up in our coats in front of the stove in the wintertime. Mama rocking back and forth with that sad ass look on the face, talking about old Shep. She actually believed you was coming back to save us or some shit. It's all right, though. I handle shit. We got a split-level duplex, big screen TV, marble floors. Mom ain't have to work. She seen more money in her life than she ever had. And I did that. I bought that back. And with us side by side, together as brothers, can't nothing stop us. Nothing.
You think I came back here to work for you?
Come on, man. We brothers. And now you working for me? We be partners.
What, selling that shit? Are you that dumb?
Fuck you think you talking to, man? This ain't nutso. This ain't that dope head on the roof taking orders from you. This ain't your same little brother following behind you trying to go outside. You ain't the motherfucking man no more. I'm the one. Shit has changed. It's a new day, bro. You can't clean up your act. I suggest you raise the fuck up. Get the hell out of Dodge. Or get caught up.
Hey, yo, God, I just want to say real thing. I know you're about to make your point. I want to do a quick little audio insert. I just thought of two things. One, somebody should make a song and sample, "I did that." Would he be like, I did that. But yo, my favorite part of that scene, every time I watch the movie, I say it with him. Would he be like, "Marble floors"? The way he say "marble floors" is the best. But anyways, go on. Just marble floor. I love that. I can't do it like you do it, but go ahead.
Just had to be one. My favorite floors. Most pinnacle scene in the film. You see what I'm saying? Because the film takes you on a tailspin, right? But this scene right here, this is the entrance. Like you bobbing off pain there. Panning through the cemetery. You know what I'm saying? So you're like, what's about to happen right now? You see him in black kneel down at the gravesite, and the camera's panning up to, who the hell is this at my mother's gravesite? From the aggressive to the little brother. He kneels down next to him. He's lower than him, right?
Look
he
at
reaches
you.
Out You're to special. His big, like he's reaching out to his big brother for love. He's not that dude, right? He's not that dude right. anymore. That he was by himself. Right. He handles. Yeah,
he's right. a razor man.
Anybody else would have been dead. You see what I'm saying? A razor man, and he got a man for the trigger. You see what I'm saying? So,
bad man.
He's in it, and he's not too far removed to get dirty, right? But he sees his brother. He sees his brother, so he kneels down at his brother's side. He hugs his brother.
And that's one of the great dark skin hugs in the film. That's a beautiful dark skin moment right there. Even though Tommy Shep is kind of like, not like, it's like you know, like you know, Birdie is all love. Shep is kind of like, you know what I mean? But anyways, keep going.
Yeah, so he knows the brother that he left. He doesn't know his brother now. They're strangers.
Right.
Jeez. You see what I'm saying? They're both strangers. But he's reaching out for his brother based off of the memory in front of his mother's gravesite, right?
Right.
So they have the dialogue, and he stands up. He's on one level. His brother's on a big brother is little brother, and little brother is big brother now.
Right.
So he's there talking to him. And his older brother senses that he's changed. So he's handling him like he wouldn't handle his little brother, but not like his little brother. He's handling him with care, right? He doesn't stand up.
Right.
He doesn't stand up because if he stands up, he's towering over him. He's letting him have this moment because he's letting him own the moment, right?
Right.
So now he's talking about, like, I was up in the bodega with mama's food stamps and motherfuckers was laughing at me. Like, he's saying to him, like, he's supposed to know, like, he ain't somebody to be played with. He's just looking at his little brother. You see what I'm saying? He's just looking at his little brother who comes into town and he sees his older brother at the gravesite with a chance of rekindling and looking for a point of, you know what I'm saying, a place to fit him in. And now he's talking to him like Big Brother. Like, he don't have no recollection.
Marble floors.
Hey, the marble floors ain't mean shit to him. You see what I'm saying? He's zoned the fuck out in this whole other zone. So he's like...
Yeah, he's like King. I'm over here, like, worship. You talk about material items. You know.
He's like... Yeah.
Think I'm gonna be working for you, selling that shit.
Fuck you think you talking to? He said, "Fuck you think you talking to?" I was like, "Ooh."
Yeah, he immediately went. Yeah, he immediately went up.
That's a sentence. That's it's a sentence, but it's one word.
Yeah,
you see what I'm saying?
Right.
So in true New York fashion, he's having the West Coast moment, like. Situation, he's like he's having all of it all in one. You see what I'm saying? So he's like, "Fuck you think you're talking to?" I'm like, he jumped at him and made it so epic. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because if you're a younger brother, you understand this frustration. And if you're an older brother, you understand this frustration too. Older brother just left. He just left the family. You see what I'm saying? His homeboy dies, he just takes off. Mama grieving at her heart, her son's gone. Youngest son getting the business because he's not the oldest son. So he's left with the responsibility that his older brother was supposed to provide for him because the pops is not even in the question. There's no thing about the father, right? Nothing about the father. So his mother passes away and he still stayed away. And he came back like, I don't know if you're going to stay or you're going to go type situation, but I'm letting you know what happened since you've been gone. I did that. I brought that back. Restoring honor to his family name via himself, right? So he's there pushing this right here. So this is his agenda. And now he's looking to put his brother on in the space. And he's like, his brother looking at him like, he doesn't realize what could happen to him. He thinks that he's still in that position to be able to even dictate terms. Think I came back here to work for you? Anybody else would have been strung up, but his brother don't know that. That's how absent-minded he is about the severity of the situation, which makes it so great. You know what I'm saying? So the protagonist and the antagonist are twins of each other in this space. The Gemini and the Pisces getting busy. Okay, the air and the water.
Leon's Pisces.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah,
and you're right. That's funny because I didn't think when we first said it, I thought the protagonist was Dwayne, but you're right. It's Leon. You're right.
Right.
Because Dwayne is just he's a device almost.
Yeah. Like everybody else is a device. Everybody. Right. You see what I'm saying? So it's literally between them. You know, you got some Bernie Mac over here. You got some Marlon Wayans over here. You know what I'm saying? You got Will Harris. Everybody, you got the coach, you got the other players on the team, you got all of that, but it's centered great around cast. Those two.
Excellent cast.
You see what I'm saying? It's centered around those two. Bernie Mac said, "Ask Scarface here. It's his brother." Dwayne's clueless. Like, he don't even know what's going on. Like, he's there. He's a centerpiece, but he's the backstory in actuality. He's the backstory while these two duke it out. For him. They're fighting for him. Right? So this is the space that comes into view. Even with Harris, as deadly as he's supposed to be, he's still expendable.
Hey, feel like the director
traveling, so now bear with me going in and out.
Do you have a good Tupac story from above the rim?
Wow. Okay, let me see a good Tupac story. I do.
Okay.
I don't know how good the story is, but I spoke to Tupac a couple of weeks before he passed. And so I spoke to him a few days, then he was shot, and then he lasted a week longer.
Mm-hmm.
But my interaction with Tupac was a good one. You know, he was very artistic. And he was a mixture of things, as we know. You can tell from his music and his regular behavior. You know a lot about Tupac from that. I will tell you this about Tupac in the movie Above the Rim. Mm-hmm. That people might not know is, so during that, he got shot the first time during that. All that stuff, the rape allegation and claim that came out and the shooting of him happened during Above the Rim, mm-hmm. right? At the end of it. So at the end, I had the director and the producer come to me and was like, okay, we're gonna change up the end of this movie. He's been shot, so we think we're gonna do this. We're not sure, but we think we're gonna do this. So they had this entirely different path to take on the film.
Mm-hmm.
Turns out they found in the crowd a lookalike who looked just like Tupac. So if you look at Above the Rim at the end of the movie, am I giving away too much right here, Rich? You're supposed to stop people when they're talking to
you. Not
me.
At
not?
All.
Because you're not the type of cat that's going to stop me from unveiling. Look at you, man. Your eyes look criminal right now. No, stop it. You're supposed to be slowing me down, bro.
No, this is...
All right.
Yes.
Well, they utilized the lookalike who happened to look a lot like Tupac, was the same stature at the end of the film, and that's how they resolved that. Other story about Tupac, what I gained from Tupac as a professional was... I realized the power of the actor from Tupac. There's a scene in the film where it's a basic, it's not even a scene, it's a clip where mm-hmm. we just drive up, get out of the car, enter the park, and that's the whole shot. So it's action, we drive, we get out, and walk in, cut. In that process, and we're in separate cars. I'm in my own car, and Tupac is in another car. He has a young lady driving him to the game. So he reaches, back in the days, they used to have knobs.
Sure.
If you remember the ones without the little thing, so you might slip up.
Yes, right. Like,
so Tupac, that's we're dating ourselves right now. That's aging us tremendously. Like I'm talking about a knob in the car.
You have to roll the window up too. Yeah, sure.
They had a roll up window, right? Right. So Tupac grabbed and slipped. So there was a rhythm to it, right? He did mm-hmm. it again, and it was like cut because he hadn't gotten out of the car.
Yeah.
So but he said, "Oh, you guys got to fix this. You know, this ain't working for me." So they said, okay, nah, let's just try it again. I think you'll be able to get it. So second time, same thing happened, right? He pulls the knob.
Yeah. Yes.
He pulls it, same thing happens. Runs out the car, gets out the car, goes to the trailer, stays in the trailer like 2 hours, right? So what did I learn from that? I learned the power of the actor because they had to come, put another knob on the car for him. He chilled out, basically smoked weed in the trailer for 2 hours. He had the set smelling like whatever it was going around.
Right?
Yeah, so, but I really did gain that because it was a real gain. I realized that once they start filming you in a movie, they're pretty much at your whim after that.
Interesting. Yeah. We had Alan Hughes, the director, on last month because he's also was directing the documentary on Tupac
mom. Oh, yeah.
And he had a history with Tupac as well that wasn't very,
I watched the
rosy.
Doc, yeah, I saw it, yeah.
So anyway, he said that if Tupac had lived, he would have rivaled Denzel in terms of Oscars, is what he said.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that was a classic clip. Okay, we going into Wood Harris mode. Or you want to talk about that scene? Because that was a classic scene where he got out the car. Are we going into Wood Harris mode? What are we doing?
We could do it all. You see what I'm saying? Let's lead in with Wood Harris because you was making a point that we didn't get a chance to hear. So,
I was just saying I felt like that scene in the graveyard. The director was trying was that scene with Pac barking on Leon was kind of like the director of the movie was trying to walk away with a I'm the one y'all need to be worried about, partner. I felt like he was trying to get that. He was trying to get one of trying to get that scene.
Get caught up. Woo-hoo!
Yeah. Like, yeah, I think he was trying to get because that scene is so reminiscent of that scene. But okay, speaking of Wood, I got to say this, man. This is an ill jewel. I never really actually. I don't know if I've ever told anybody this because it dawned on me. I shouldn't even say it dawned on me. Wood mentioned this in an interview, and it hit me. Wood, the very first thing he was in was Above the Rim. And similarly, the very first thing I was in was All Eyes on Me. So me and Wood share that in common that the very first thing we were in were Pac things. Just wanted to share that because it's fun. And I actually sat, Wood came came to one of the early screenings of All Eyes on Me and told me he approved of my portrayal of Shock G. But I was going to say, with Wood, man, I mean, first of all, that's like a crazy thing to just think about. He came in like that. That's the first thing. You know what I'm saying? Got to be a motherfucking soldier. And that shit with the toothpick, with that toothpick, and he's looking back with that look, that look when he puts a toothpick in his mouth, and he has that look like he really embodied, like, the tough nigga that's very concerned that you're believing his toughness. Because there's some motherfuckers that are tough that just ain't. They just sitting there and they ain't giving a fuck. But then there's motherfuckers that are tough, but they're like, you believe in me, right? Like they want to make sure you feeling it. And he really embodied that scene. Like I mean, he embodied that energy so well in that scene. I mean, he's like really, you wouldn't go as far to say Woods stole the show of the movie because there's a lot of people in it. So you know, people use those expressions loosely. He stole a lot of scenes. And that scene where he got out and he pistol whipped the dude, and the way he gets out of the car, my money was like, man, I got, like he comes out talking that like, man, I got, like real quick, just throws a little, he has a bunch of little shit, the little uncertainty he has when he takes the biscuit and he's getting ready to shoot, fuck is Dwayne Martin's character name? Kyle. He's getting ready to shoot Kyle. And like that little unsure footwork. Like he has a lot of like nuances in that movie, man, and like he did an incredible job, man. Wood, and it's amazing to see where he's come from that. But when you go back to that, his foundation is strong. Like there's some actors, you know, like for example, but there's a certain actor. It ain't necessary to say it's a white actor. Nothing that matters, but. Just to be clear, that like people talk, he's one of the greatest actors ever lived. But you look at his early work, I'm like, you couldn't see it. I couldn't see it. It wasn't there yet. He must have went to the crossroads and met that man and made that deal, and now he's that boy. But I was gonna say, Wood, you could see it from jump. Like he had it. He was that dude from the jump, and his part was kind of a small part, but a crucial part. Like some of those looks. Like some, because he plays the ultimate background big man, but if you compare him to a lot of the other big men, like they just be like the stoic brick in the background, just the gargoyle. It's like your man is not a gargoyle. He's in the back really with personality. He's always doing something with that camera time. So it's a real blessing that he was the one chosen for that role.
What about Flip? Goddamn shame what happened to Flip.
Come on, man. Woo!
They didn't have to discuss that. It wasn't, it was understood.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? He's like, woo, woo, woo. I said, oh, this is why they call it birdie. Okay, he did that bird call. And he moving the bird. Okay, I understand. It's like, all right.
Yeah, that scene where they crept up on him in that camera angle, man. Yeah. that camera angle of them creeping up on Flip was fucking ominous as shit. And your man, you know, that's why you see I wore the hat, man. I wore the hat in tribute to motherfucking Wood, man. I low-key got my shit on, you know what I mean? I have other hats with me right now. I'm a traveling man. I wore this fucking with my guy Wood. What's my bruh, man? That's Big Bruh. He a rapping motherfucker too, by the way. Wood's a real nigga. Right. I love Wood to death, man. He is special human being.
Libra.
That's a fact. That's a fact. And that shit was big, man. I want to jump to another scene that highlights another character. When you said Flip, let's talk about Bernie real quick. Yes. That dance he did when he walked, you don't want none of this, baby. You want none of this. Like, there's certain things that you see that you know were not in the yes. script. Your man Bernie Mac took that and... That shit. I mean, first of all, what's so funny is that game. I never heard anybody ever talk about books. Like, that shit was just some ill movie shit. Like, I mean, maybe niggas in Harlem was on that then, but I just remember watching it being like, wow. And he's like throwing the ball at him. Like, the basketball work in that movie was phenomenal. Dwayne's really that guy. So the so that whole scene where he was clowning dude, he's throwing the ball back to Maul and hitting him. And like, but Bernie Mac, after getting served up like that, just says, no, nigga, watch this. And just reverse polarity on his ass and just puts him down. Puts him like, nah, man, it's me. And shit, that scene was so ill. That scene was so ill, man. Bernie Mac, man. That's another one of, because, like, I don't know how many movies Bernie Mac was in. He's in some movies. But that one is so unique. Because he doesn't have a suit on. Right. How about that? I think he might have a suit on in every other movie he's ever in. Right? Like, he's got a suit on in Friday. He's got a suit on in House Party 3. He's got a suit on in da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. He's got a suit on in the movie he's in with Isaac Hayes.
Yeah, they're parallel scenes. You see what I'm saying? Like, him in life and him in the kind of life.
You're right. Like,
parallel.
Yeah.
And characteristics. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He said, hey, you see Shep? He said, what, you looking for some dick? Like it's just,
yeah.
I'm going to use every moment that I have on this camera. Anytime this camera's at me, I got you. So I'm there, I'm cameoing, I'm out. You see what I'm saying?
How about the classic? Sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was like, how about the classic? They can't take away what we was.
Yes.
Can't forget what we was. And he walk off with his hand, and then that music, like the music comes in, little smooth jazz with the little flute or whatever's going on. That shit is butter. Like, that was nice they gave him that scene, and then go on, Flip. Leon is before we go there, so I don't forget, you tell me you've seen the clip in like 2017 when Leon pulled up to Rucker dressed as Shep and play ball. Tell me you've seen that.
Yes.
Yeah, the man was the wildest. But I was gonna say, he just walked on. I was like, that's one of the most legendary things ever. But I would love to hear him explain his decision, and you know. But anyways, I was gonna say, top. There's a lot of scenes in that movie. Top five, okay. Not like I was gonna say top five scenes for me, just because it's so funny. Is the scene with baby girl like,
you look like you could use a woman to give you a cook you a man nice meal and give you some loving and run you a bath and do all that. What you got to say about that? How would you give me another glass of water? That shit, the look on his face, because when you watch that scene, that was not an actor. That was not Tommy Shep. That was Leon. Man. That was Leon, no last name having ass.
Yes, for a Leon, 1,000 years.
That's post-Madonna. That's
Yeah, that's post Madonna. That's post knife fight with Sylvester Stallone and Cliffhanger. That's Leon really on his Leon shit. Like Leon was really
post,
like
post Oz, post everything.
I mean, can you? Your boy was there. Your boy. But yeah, Leon. But real quick. I want you to stay away from my mom's. Like, I couldn't. That scene when Leon stuck his head down and walked away. That scene is so, like, dramatically fake and extra, but it's funny. Like, right. That's the one scene that I feel like the acting is really, I mean, for Leon, the one scene in the movie where the acting is not accurate, but it's classic. He just puts his head down and walks off like a little nigga. I'm like, yo, man, that ain't. Yo, yeah, Leon, man, He and his basketball shit was looking strong, man. Your man was looking that one Dr. J layup where he had the full extendo, looking like George Gervin or something. I was like, look at the Iceman.
He's out there on the court playing against himself. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
We're going right there. Okay. The guy who arguably stole the show, if I had to give it to anybody, is Marlon Wayans. Now, I'm going to say this, right? This is Marlon Wayans' best film he ever was in and the best film he ever will be in. Like, for him. Because I fuck with Marlon Wayans, but sometimes it's just too much, man. That movie, though, man, he was like, you know, you get what I'm saying. But in that movie, yo, he said, money's playing ball without a ball. Like, that shit is priceless, and that whole shit. You need a hug. Like you need a hug or something. Like all that shit in the car. That whole scene where he's in the car with them. He just like imagine the outtakes that they don't have because he was so on fire in that scene. Imagine what didn't make the movie. Like I guarantee you, there's like another 3 minutes of just like. Hilarious shit that didn't because he was killing. He's
and him snapping on right, and him snapping on the whole team. You know that scene.
Yeah,
he's like this brother over here looking like Lurch. You rang like I know yeah, they have a whole scene where he going crazy on everybody in the place. I know it. Like I know that there's some footage of him. It's too classic. It's too iconic for him not to be in there getting everybody in the joint.
No way. But how about though the freestyle and the whip? Stab up my own mama like Jeffrey Dahmer. I'm a wild type of nigga with that comma. All that. Yo, your man was in rare. He was in his like crystallized B-boy New York nigga shit because he's really that. And a lot of people don't know he's really that. Like, so he was really like, he got to be the exaggerated version of that. You know what I mean? And he just was so like on his shit. That it's, oh man, your man said, what did he say? He said, what did he say? He said, oh man, it's something he said. Because I can't get past that scene in the car. Like just that scene in the truck alone was like so epic. Like he was just smashing, but that whole shit with the baby powder, like he was doing the most in that movie, man. Wait, man. All the ways, man.
Get off of me.
It's like I'm trying to remember these lines because they're like they're coming, the yeah, get off me, ah, you know what I mean?
Hey, Onyx was playing in the whip. Onyx will make you hop out the whip and beat the shit out of somebody. Oh, that scene
when he first sees him, when he first catches up with him, he's like, oh, how did he, when he grabbed him and he put his hand on his head, and he was like, ah. Yeah, Onyx, what?
Onyx is playing.
No, I didn't hear what you said about Onyx. Say it again.
No, I was saying Onyx is playing in the whip. Onyx will jump out the whip and beat the shit out of somebody. So Slam is playing and he hops out the whip.
Oh, right. Wow. Yeah, no, that shit was like, and when he put his hand on Kyle's homeboy head, the dude was like, Like, fuck, that shit was hilarious, man. That shit, bruh. Yo, he really came through in the clutch in that movie and was like, because he's the funny, I mean, he is the, and then, but even he held down his dramatic parts. Like, what he did to that bum flip, what you think he gonna do to me? You know what I mean? And when he got punked in the club, like, he was real believable. Like, he was like, there's not a scene in that movie that he wasn't, like, right where he was supposed to be and right. And you low-key can't say that about necessarily everybody. Like I said, you know, Tommy should put the head down was a little bit. But I felt like Maul and really Boogaloo, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
Boogaloo. And, That whole scene where Bruh's taking a piss, yikes! That shit was super pause, but it was like it was kind of funny because, like, you know, it was like a, how can I put it, like, acknowledgement of like a time old thing that men from the beginning of time have wondered, like, are they? You know, everybody, everything is competition, right? So, like, it was an ill way to, like, go there. Like, it was like, whoa, but you watch it. When he looks at his joint and he nods his head, like, yeah. Like, the subtlety of that scene is because at first you're like, yo, what is he doing? He's looking at his man's joint. But then now all of a sudden he's looking back at his shit like, yeah, I'm superior. So it was like low-key, like, they made you fall for the bait. Like, the bait was like, why is he looking at his man's pipe? But now it's like, oh, my shit's superior. Like, that shit was wild. Like, that movie is bugged out, man. That movie is
that movie is bugged out.
Oh, shit.
Judah Priest, 144,000 zone in the building. Look at him. Look at him.
Say what? Priest here?
Nah, Judah Priest. Not Killer Priest, the other priest, oh, Judah Priest, 144 times.
Yeah, peace, Lord. Yeah, but no, but enough can't be said about Marlon. And then the wild shit was that Marlon was the one that you know sent the fatal shot to Birdie, you know, which we now know was a lookalike, which makes me feel better about just the way that scene played out. Cause that must have been be a terrible thing. Anybody that was a friend with the guard to have to like do that in a movie and then it happened in real life, like just energetically you wouldn't want that. But it's cool to know that was. Like a really well, and but man, there's you know what's bothering me? There's a joke in the car that I can't. Oh, he's okay. He said, this nigga just mad because he gonna be sitting on the bench. And then he said, anyways, it'll come to me later. I'll leave it in the comments later.
I'll leave it in the comments. Man. Yeah, this movie was crazy.
Yeah.
I think Birdie has some ill scenes too. Besides the scene that I played. He's out there, superstar Monarch.
Say it again.
He's out there. He's like superstar Monarch.
And what up?
Then he had like the sports agent dude waiting for him in the club. Like he put all that together and made it look like it was haphazard. You know, the Italian guy comes to him. He's like, what are you, like a size 12? 11 and a half.
Yo, what?
You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah, hello?
Yeah, you hear me?
Yeah, I'm going through a little bit of a rough patch right now.
All right, hold on. Give me.
from the darkness came in, it came into light.
Bed-Stuy, I'm from Gateside. I was born in Bushwick. My upbringing is in Bed-Stuy. And a lot of MCs came through my block. A lot. Big Daddy came, Jay-Z, Jazzo, and a lot of them came up. My block was like a haven for that. I'm a fan of rap and art of it. So just being that, just being a fan of it make me want to push a little harder. You know, so I had a mixture of gods and Hebrew Israelites and Islam, you know, so it came from a lot of mixture. I kind of like had a lot of this energy that was in there. So it's like a different type of philosophies in there.
But they didn't give it, when it came in, it slid, because it never was just set. It was like, you got a demo deal. So the demo deal, at first, you stress out, like, damn, I got a demo deal. That's good. But just say deal. You know, once you hand in the songs, then you got the deal. So I handed in the songs. But I wanted to hear, yo, the deal's yours.
And three of us formed the Maccabees out of that. And Hellraiser came, and then Timbo came. It was supposed to be all five of us, but it didn't work out. We got Black Market. We'll talk about that later.
It was my song. It was a song I had called As I Die Slowly. So it was the same thing, and then we just called it America. It was the whole clan. So there's a song called As I Die Slowly. So I said, yo, I got the song. Because they would say, yo, we wanted something for AIDS. So I said,
Yeah. Yo, you were saying about the sports agent, dude?
Yeah, I was saying, like, Birdie had the whole thing set up to make it look like it was haphazard. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was just, like, it happened to happen. At this particular time, this dude comes in, and he said, oh, I need to holler at you about something later on. And then he uses that to say, okay, this is what I'm involved in. Like, this is my level of influence. You see what I'm saying? To hook him in. So he came in there, he brought him upstairs. He was like, relax, he's with me. To the security, and then they go upstairs into the spot. And, you know, Shorty's up there waiting on him. So everything looks as if it's circumstantial, like it just happened to happen right there, but it's all planned to show him this is the level of the game. This is where we at. You see what I'm saying? So they do them like they did Detroit Red in the X movie. You see what I'm saying? So he goes over there. He's like, wow. Man. He's like, so they're talking about what kind of country name is that? He's like, Kali Watson. You like, look like you're supposed to have an afro out here. Like, so they do him like that. And then they take him upstairs. And Shorty's like, he like, relax. Maybe it's his first time. You see what I'm saying? So he's like, everything in here cost. Everything. He missed a jewel in that. He missed two jewels. He's like, you got any family? He said, it's just me and my moms. He said, being alone makes you strong. You learn a lot of life that way. That's what he said to him, right? He's reflecting on his own self via him. So he sees him, but then he's also saying, okay, I could put my grips into him like this. So I'm doing that on some training day shit. How's your Espanol? Okay? Like that shit looked like it seemed random. Everything was perfectly placed, right? One day we got to go through the training day shit. I need you with the training day montage, okay? So he walks up into this space, and Kyle thinks like, okay, I'm just walking in this place, and he's showing me around and blah, blah, blah. So everything's timed perfectly. Shorty's waiting upstairs.
I can't take your money, Birdie. I can't take your money, Birdie. When he said that line, like, so flimsy, so flimsy. I can't take your money, buddy.
He's like, come on, you embarrassing me. You a guest. And then he reminded him. He reminded him that everything cost. And he said, everything. Go ahead.
What's amazing is the smile I had. By the way, the lighting in that scene is some of the best lighting. The lighting
in that scene is some of the best lighting. They have Pac looking like, that shit is pre-Hype Williams. They had that shit looking like Pac was like this blue ethereal and the shine in his eyes and he's smiling, looking like the character he represents is like, you know, the evil temptation inducer, you know, kind of guy to get you wrapped up. But he's got like the most like friendly smile. Like it's really masterfully executed.
Yeah, he's sadistic. He's sadistic. He's walking around with a razor blade in his cheek and he just pulls it out at will. Like, and you don't see him put it back properly. He just jibs it into his jaw like nothing. So, yeah. like this is the most sinister shit I've seen.
I assume that Pac was really working. Pac was probably like, he called a couple cats he knew that was like New York niggas that knew was on that. It was like, we working on it. I got to get this right for the movie.
Just right for the movie. Yes.
It's got to be right for the movie. Because that's what's amazing too, is like, and that's a classic, you bringing that up is a good point, because like, that's such an iconic street thing that like is particular to the East Coast. It's not really that known on the West like that, but so Pac was the one that took it and really like, what other movie did anybody really do it like that? Nobody. Like he did it with swag and style. Like he kind of owns that. Like if you said who's the razor in the mouth nigga to a New York tough guy, they're gonna be like, they probably gonna name, you know, Pistol Pete to somebody who, you know, he got the intro to his dog, you know, they're gonna name somebody like that who's iconic on the street level. But you say, okay, yeah, but what about in entertainment? It's not, without question, it's Pac and Above the Rim. I mean, he like, he that's his shit. You know what I mean?
Body. He does it, body, and then he puts it back, and then he laughs to show you, like, I didn't slip this under my tongue, none of that. I got it in my, you understand what I'm saying? Like, it's there. So it's like, like, I'm like, oh, he's a nut, for real. Like, this is how you put this sadistic joint out there. You see what I'm saying? Like, there's some other, that's how you get into character. This is a different kind of space that I'm in right now. Like, yeah, okay, yeah, I'm exactly walking this line right here. Yeah, so, yeah.
That's so funny you say that. You know what's funny? I'm going to start. Everybody loves to talk about Marlon Brando putting cotton balls in his mouth to play the Godfather. Let's take it to the next level, man. Pac with the razor blade. And look, to be fair, we're going to assume that it was a dull razor blade. We're not going to assume that he had a real sharp joint playing games out there with his life. You know, as a vocalist. As a vocalist.
Now, I know a homegirl who used to keep the razor. I know a homegirl squad that used to keep the razor blades.
Oh, no. I know it's many individuals like the Pistol Pizza of the world that keep it sharp. But I'm just saying, I'm gonna assume that
I could call their name right now. I know a female crew with somebody you might know as a rapper, female rapper, okay, who ran with a crew of girls who was the baddest of the bad that will slice your throat, okay? That will slice your throat with the razor blades under the tongue. Like, you know, some women in L.A. and in Oakland who got the razor blades in their hair. This is what they had in the afro. You understand what I'm saying? like the Midwest cats with the straight razor. You know what I'm saying? Like it was literally in that vein. That's a kind of different kind of sadistic that you got to be to stab somebody, to cut somebody. Right.
And they had Pac looking the grimiest when he put it on. Put it on flip. Yeah, that was you know, there's a bunch of other little things in that movie that are fascinating too. Like, you know what's a fun fact? So that first game, I don't know if it's necessarily the first game, but that the game where Kyle is doing the most with the dribble and not ain't passing nobody, and he's at the end, he talks to this recruit like, I know it's more to life than whatever the fuck. We can talk. Like, the white dude that's defending him.
Yeah.
The white dude that's defending him, the point guard of the other team, is the guy that was on the first season of MTV Real World.
Was it?
Facts. So crazy. Fun facts. So it's like if you like if anybody was intrigued by him, he has a whole like slice of a year of his life on MTV. Like I remember it was like fun little there's like a lot of this. That's why the cast of that movie is really like ill on the low because I mean what's bruh that played Tommy Shep's partner, the other security guard? Your right. man was your man was I forget his name, but he's a certified actor in a lot of shit. He's like
right.
he's a cool little role. But yo, you know what's another thing in that movie
is that my man that was in South Central?
Yes, it was. Exactly. He played the
Is that Ray Ray? Is that Ray Ray?
Yeah, Ray Ray. That's Ray Ray. Exactly.
Ray Ray don't care about nobody. Okay, Ray Ray.
He said, thanks, Ray Ray. That little dude, man, was a wow, Ray Ray. Hit some bud. Jesus. Thanks, Ray Ray. Poison my. But yo, I was going to say, that's funny. He said Ray Ray. I forgot that was his name. But man, how about this? Another fun fact. We talking about the soundtrack. But what crept into that movie, still West Coast, but not Death Row at all, was that scene where your man was walking with Marlon and he seen his mom's in the diner with motherfucking Tommy Shep and they threw that Far Side on there. Oh, shit.
What did I say to Lisa? I'm so slick.
Like, that shit is amazing that the Far Side record snuck in the midst of all that Death Row shit and that pop. I was like, amazing. But once again, Marlon's portrayal of a guy who's with a nigga who's watching his moms go out with the, you know, it's priceless. Yo, that mom, she was fierce. She slapped the shit out that boy and said,
yes.
Who the, what? No, I can't remember the line, but she was fierce. And then how she shifted into some you think you could just hug me like that? That was a hard scene. That scene is gangster because everybody felt that. Like, oh, my mom said the same shit to the nigga at the door that she said to him. Like that scene hurt. Like every time I watched it, I'm like, damn, it, oh, like ah. That's like one of those, oh, that shit hurt. That's a great that movie is like is really like a really, really good movie. Like, see, that's one thing that has to be acknowledged. We got to keep it funky. A lot of times with movies, with hip-hop motherfuckers we love, we could just love on the motherfucking cast so much that sometimes we could just make a lot of excuses and passes for a lot of shit. So sometimes people will talk about other movies like they lit or like they really good movies, but they really not. It's just like you like the main star or the cast or this particular comedian and this particular person has a cameo that's so classic, so we just loving it. But like then there's certain movies, and that's one thing that's the thing about Pac. If you think about it, damn, I just had a wow, I'm about to do the knowledge radio. Are you ready for a world premiere right now? This is a breaking news. I'm the nigga that says it first. Hump is claiming full. I'm claiming this. This is a moment. Tupac is the John Cazale of hip hop. For everybody that John Cazale is the actor that played Fredo in The Godfather. Mm. If you look him up, he was in 5 movies. Every movie he was in was nominated for Best Picture. And I believe 3 or 4 of them won Best Picture. He was in Godfather, Godfather 2, Serpico, Deer Hunter, no, and Dog Day Afternoon. Was he in Serpico? I might be wrong about Serpico, but he was definitely in Godfather 1 and 2, Deer Hunter, Dog Day Afternoon, and I might be wrong about that 5th one. But the point that I'm making is he's in 5 movies. And whether or not this is the 70s shit. Those are all like, you know, Best Picture nominees, iconic films of like all time. So when people that talk about him, like, first of all, if you watch Godfather 2, if you really mature, realize the best performance in the film is by him, the guy that plays Fredo. If you really watch, because you get caught up in Michael Corleone, you get caught up in De Niro, but if you really watch Fredo's role, what he had to do, the acting to play all those, that awkward energy, all that shit. Yes. I was overlooked, Mikey. You know, it wasn't for me, all of that shit.
You're my kid brother. That, so you're my kid brother.
He did the best performance. Yeah. He, come on, man. And all of that, I mean, he's a fucking, so, but if you look him up, there's a lot of articles that he's like, considered like the greatest actor that was ever lost type shit, because he's in five movies and each movie he just destroys him. And it's like, look at Pac, bro. Pac was in five movies and each one of those motherfuckers is, they weren't, none of them were nominated for Best Picture, but not one of those. Like, first of all, let's just go here. Off rip, Juice and Poetic Justice are motherfucking masterpieces. To me, they're on a higher level. The next level would be Above the Rim and Gridlocked. Then to me, the next level would be Gang Related. You know what I mean? And Bullet. Mm-hmm. And Bullet was ill too. So he's the sixth. Bullet, they don't play that on TV. That's the movie where he was back on the Slick Rick tip with the hats. Yeah. Your man was crazy in that. He had the eye patch on, and him and Mickey Rourke
grabbed the little girl up. Yeah, he grabbed the little girl up. Next time you see me, it'd be gunfire where it follows. Yeah, come on.
I love you. That's why I love you, camera. So it's funny to think about it. Like he every movie he's in, obviously weren't nominated for Best Picture, but.
Him and Jim Belushi. You don't get popped by other cops when you were a cop. I was like, man, it was too much. It was too much. It was too much.
He had grown up with the fashion. Pac was a young man and had already grown up with the fashion. He had on, like, you know, James Belushi's over there wearing a little regular ass shirt. Pac was like, nah, man, I've got a tie on in every scene. Fuck with me. You know what I mean? Right. And to consider he was supposed to be in Higher Learning and Menace. Thank you. So to think about that, like, I always wondered what he was going to play in Higher Learning, because I never heard them say what role. We know in Menace he was supposed to play Sharif. He was supposed to play Q's part. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I heard it. Look, was between Ice Cube and Busta Rhymes. Oh. So between those two characters, one or the other.
I
could really see him doing the Ice Cube character more justice than Ice Cube did. Because Ice Cube was kind of, he was okay.
Look what his homeboy did to your face, Busta. My favorite scene in that movie, without question. What, this set? He ain't fading nothing over here, though. That's my favorite. She's like, what, this set? He ain't fading nothing over here, though. Yo.
They just hate Busta me because they hate that. Me.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
So, yo, by the way, while we're here, I got to say something. In all of movies, if you'd have called me an hour ago and said, yo, what are the five scenes in movies that you wish were different? Mm-hmm. There's five scenes in movies that I wish, if I could change history, I would change. I can't list all five of them right now because, you know, we don't need to, but I'm going to give you two just for reference. In Pulp Fiction, the scene when Bruce Willis, I hope Bruce Willis is doing well, we love you, Bruce. I'll say Bruce, when he gets in the back of the car with Esmeralda, the cab driver, he's like, what, do you get off on people that kill people? It is a subject I have much interest in. I've never met anyone who killed anyone before.
What does it feel like to kill a man?
Yeah, exactly. And she says, I've never met anybody who killed someone before. What the character should have said is, that's what everyone thinks. Or something like that. because everybody's met somebody that's killed somebody. You go into a gas station, the motherfucker kill somebody. If you've been around, you've met a million people, you've met somebody. So I always felt like that scene was a missed moment in the dialogue. Like that shit would I mean, just imagine that one line would have.
Her accent was that so
line
dope.
Would echo throughout eternity.
Her accent was so dope, and the scene was so dope.
Yo, say it again.
You know what he said? You know what he said in that scene?
Yo, hold on. I can't. Yo, say something.
Yo,
say something. I can't hear you. There you go.
Yo. All right. He said.
Yeah, you're good.
You know what I said her accent was so thick. Like, I love the fact. Even if she faked it, she made it believable just for that little bit of time. The gypsy cab driver scene. We know the gypsies, right? And for a gypsy woman to say, I never known somebody to kill a man, is really crazy. Because they kill at young ages, very young ages. They don't give a fuck about rules and laws, right? So they roll and do how they do. So that was a funny thing to be an older woman to say she never known somebody to kill a man, right?
You went deep on that. That's deep.
Now look
and
at
I've
the
been
other
watching
part.
Peaky. I've been watching Peaky Blinders heavy recently. So the gypsy. Shouts to the gypsies.
Right. So.
But yeah, that would have been a. Oh yeah, sorry. Go.
The other part. I agree with you. That's a classic line to insert. But the other part is Bruce Willis said the illest shit in the movie already. So for him to say something ill on top of that would have fucked it up. He said, what's your name? Esmeralda. She said what it means. He said, what's your name? He said, Butch. He said, what does that mean? He said, I'm America, honey. Our names don't mean shit. You understand what I'm saying? Like
right. Hey, so let me tell you the other.
Coming out with his foreign broad after, you know, the whole skirmish and shit, right? He leaves Red Rains, go back to get his broad. She's like, what happened to my Honda? She's like, whose motorcycle is this? It's not a motorcycle, baby. It's a chopper. Whose chopper is this? It's Zed's. Who's Zed? Zed's dead, baby. Dead. You understand what I'm saying? Like I don't got no time to explain this shit else to you. You understand what I'm saying? All you need to know is that is dead, okay? So the dude in the ring, well, he's dead, and Zed's dead. You understand what I'm saying? And the gimp.
Yeah. And the gimp. Yo, I always think about that girl, that French girl, and I don't know if she's a big ass. I mean, I always think about, but when I watch the movie, I mean, like, I don't know if she's a big actress in France, but I do know she walked away with the all-time, like, for whatever women love Bruce Willis, like, she's, like, owns that nigga in the physical world in a movie. Like, there's no other woman that got up in that nigga armpits like she did. Like, she's way up in him. Like their shit is, like, because he obviously had sex scenes, but if you really think about it, Bruce is more of an action guy. There really ain't a lot of sex scenes. Like, I can't even think of Bruce taking nothing down in the movie. But so in that movie, she just smeared all up on that nigga. You know what I mean? For like, that shit
will
is
you give me oral pleasure?
Yeah, I mean, it's like, right. As I'm saying, she really, like, I know there's a lot of women that hate her for just
got
that.
Like a cracked rib and all that shit. Like, she don't give a fuck.
She don't give a fuck. She want pancakes with blueberries. She's going to cry if she don't get them, and he loves her for it.
And
he loves
this motherfucker left that goddamn, left that goddamn watch at the house. He wanted to strangle her. Like, you can't write into a scene that on-set chemistry where he looked like he could have beat her motherfucking ass to death.
You know what's
in that
crazy
scene about that watch, like,
what's
and,
crazy
and the
is,
fear, and the fear of I gotta leave and go back to my house and get it. I know these motherfuckers is looking for
me. Yo, that scene where he's in the car and he's really articulating that's the epitome. Like that, I remember when I first saw that, I was like, no one ever captured that in a movie. Like what it's like after you're like, I fucking told her, it's right there, it's sitting up. Like, I remember when I first seen it, I was like, wow, that's really how you feel. Like, you're like I fuck the pool bedside second. Like he really
he
caught that scene.
He banging shit in the car, like he going through it. Yeah, he going through it.
Second scene in a movie that bothers me to this day that should have been fixed was in Shaft. Busta Rhymes is chilling at the crib with his Earth daughter, Jamaican guy. Mm-hmm. Busta Rhymes, Jamaican with a Jamaican cat, him still have the dread there. All of that thing. So all of them thing. So he's in the scene and Shaft calls him, yo, I need you to do this. He's like, yo, man, I'm chilling. He's like, I need you. He's like, all right, dog. All right, dog. Hangs up the phone. Hold up. He hangs up the phone. Hangs up the phone. The girl goes, What going on? And he looks at her and goes, yeah, baby, I got to handle something for my man real quick. Man, what a fucking ball drop. He should have looked to her and been like, he should have went full patois on her right there. And it would have been so lit. And it would have, but they wasn't thinking, man. They wasn't thinking. So that's, every time I see that scene, like literally if I'm watching that movie and that's on, I might flip the channel for that scene because it just bothers me. I'm a weird nigga. Like, shit bothers me sometimes. I just, it's like watching a wasted moment. I hate watching wasted moments. Really, really bother me. Like, it's just, it's like when the cameraman is looking here, but the action's over there and you see the action, it just, it like, I never forget them. Like, I like it, it'll haunt me. Like, I have memories of cameramen pointing the camera 10 feet to the right when some amazing shit's happening that just will haunt me and I'll never get over it. I'll just never get over it. But anyway, Above the Rim. Woo! What a film.
That was two. Huh? Come on. We here.
Oh, yeah. I was going to do all five. I don't even remember the other ones. I have to sit and think. Those are just the two on hand. Yeah.
So the Busta Rhymes scene that in the Shaft film, I didn't appreciate when he said, where's my shit at? And he doesn't produce a gun and he doesn't bust a shot. It didn't make no sense. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
He's like, hold on.
Where's my shit? I'm like, okay, Busta Rhymes the kid in there. Bust. I was like, man, that was the biggest letdown right there.
Hey, that movie, low-key, there's certain movies that are like when they're made, like no one knew to what degree the actors in that movie were. I mean, yo, that movie has Christian Bale and Jeffrey Wright, right? I mean, like, you know, like Christian Bale is like Jeffrey Wright is still. I'm not talking about skill. Jeffrey Wright, in my opinion, is probably right now just entering the fade. Like he's just entering the Christian Bale status. Because you got to understand, Christian Bale's been an A-list dude for a minute. I mean, he's played Batman. He's been at the star of multiple major big budget films. Jeffrey Wright is just, I mean, American Fiction was not even a major budget film like that. Like, but it got those kind of accolades. So he's really coming into that space of like, but he's been that boy since the 90s, since he played Basquiat, in my opinion. And right. I was going to say, which is another movie with a phenomenal cast. You got Jeffrey Wright playing Jean-Michel. You got Benicio Del Toro playing his man. You got Gary Oldman, playing the LR Collector. You got David Bowie playing Andy Warhol. You got Michael Wincott. If y'all don't remember who that is, that's your man with the crazy face that played in Robin Hood with Kevin Costner, the sheriff of Nottingham, mm-hmm. his homeboy. He's also the dude in Count of Monte Cristo with the crazy, he got the crazy face. And the cast of that movie is fucking insane. There's somebody else in there that I can't think of right now, but that movie is the cast is ridiculous. So, but back to Shaft, it's like that scene with Jeffrey Wright and all the scenes with Jeffrey Wright and Christian Bale banging out are phenomenal. Mm-hmm. But that one scene in particular where, spoiler alert, where your man takes him out through that window and puts the knife through his hand and put this in your fucking ass. And then when he gets up, I mean, just the aggressiveness, but when he gets up and he slips on the glass like that, it was like, who is this nigga? How do you act like that? Like, how do you do that? Incredible, man. I bet you his leg still hurts to this day. He's like, look, this is what it takes, man. This is what it takes. My fucking hip still, his hip still probably funny behind that scene. Because if you really watch that scene, that ain't like, his hip really slid, bruh. Yeah. Like, Like, I fuck with Jeffrey Wright at the highest level, man.
Yo.
I haven't seen American Fiction yet. I want to, though. Go ahead.
They killed his brother. He hops out the whip. Shots is firing. He pulls out the ice pick and starts stabbing himself in the chest. You might as well kill me. You might
kill
as well.
You
forgot that that's Jeffrey Wright. That's Peoples. Like you got like
bro.
A stab. You got a tear in your eye for his brother. Like, oh, it's about to go down. Okay. Pulled up with the skirt, 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 skirt. He come out with the bulletproof vest and the walk. And I'm like, oh shit. I'm like, hell yeah.
Yeah. No. First of all, he bodied. If that movie was I was gonna say, if that movie was Meth vs. Chef, we ain't gonna say who did what. But on that song, in that movie, you know, Jeffrey Wright, he fucking murdered Christian Bale. But he made the movie. But truth be told, he just had the best character. I mean, Shaft was cool, but like, you know, but Peoples was the whole movie. But that scene where he's sitting there eating at the window and bruh throws the basketball, and then when he comes down there with that force, that's one of the greatest mob up on the nigga scenes you ever see ever in life. He came through with the fury of everything. Like, Peoples was, but how about that scene?
And my man from The Wire is in there talking to the police.
Yeah, come on.
He's talking crazy to him, and then he gave him that look. He's like, the eyes.
But how about the scene in the diner when Shaft is like, if I see you, da da da, I'll kill you. He's like, why did you talk to me? I like you. You wanna play with me, whatever. And then when Shaft walks
out
the door,
I like you.
He punks the bouncer dude, like the bouncer dude, like the security dude. And people are like, puta, why you flinch?
That shit is priceless. Everyone's priceless.
He said, like, I heard so Shaft in that moment has one of the greatest lines. He said, do you think that makes me less dangerous or more dangerous? You see what I'm saying? Like.
Hello. Mekhi Pfeiffer played the brother that took the pipe to the head. Pause. I was gonna say, yo,
dog.
Mekhi Pfeiffer had it.
Yo, dog. He said, "You got that, Tupac?" I said, "Damn!" I said, "This dude is wild, disrespectful."
He said, "You got that, Tupac?" I'm trying to remember that part.
And he took the pipe to the head. Remember, like, he followed him outside and he bashed his head in. Like he's talking to him. He's like, you got that, Tupac? And he did that shit. I was like, damn, this dude is.
Oh, wild. Right. This and then when he, yeah, that movie was wild. That movie was a wild, wild movie, man. And Shaft was ill, but okay, back to Above the Rim. What else? Let's see. What have we not? I remember that workout scene. I was never much of a workout dude, but there are times where I tried to emulate that. Like, I was never like a hard workout guy, ankle front. But that workout scene was, I remember just like watching it being like,
with the epic shiznit.
The shiznit.
Styles.
Yeah, the shiznit.
Nah, it's not the shiznit. It's pump.
Oh, it's pump. Right. Pump.
Come on, fam.
Man. Yeah, you're right. That shit was.
I'll pack up. I see any battle I'm in. I can't be beat. So, yeah, that was my shit right there.
Yeah, Jamal. And that was back in the era when Georgetown Hoyas was like the number one merchandise. Georgetown Hoyas, they had the, man, I wonder how much money they made on merch, because it was like, you didn't know. I mean, you know, I guess some Bloods didn't have that, but everybody that wasn't a Blood had something from them. They would just had all the, like, and I remember, because him coming down from that scene with that sweatsuit on, and we was already on it before, so then we seen, I remember those days when fashion would be like, you'd be rocking a something, like a brand or something, but then when the movie come out and the star of the movie's wearing it, forget it. You just, whatever money you have is going right to, you buy a Georgetown Hoyer sticker if that's all you got is $2. You,
yes.
Yeah, classic, man. Above the rim, man. That's a, yeah, Pac,
this
man.
This is 94, man. Like, SWV's on the soundtrack with motherfucking Method Man, You Got an Old Dirty Bastard.
The Wu-Tang remix ain't on the soundtrack.
Is it? Well, it came out around the same
time. Yeah, the remix, yeah, that was one of those, another platinum here, but another one of those. Yeah. By the way, You God, I love You God. This is message to You God, I love You God. Man, stop acting like you wasn't on that remix, God. You was on that remix, man. You God be talking about, like, more looks. Man, you was on the SWV remix, man. That was a super look. Yo, shout out to You God.
Another chapter for the Wu-Tang.
Let me tell you my favorite You God moment. This is a You God appreciation moment because You God, I think, is arguably the most, you know, people talk about the most underrated. See, underrated is an interesting word, but sometimes people use underrated and it's not really the word. What You Got is the most people act like he's not that nigga. Like, because, like, people will say, you know, motherfucker will say some shit like Black Thought is the most underrated, but everybody, you'll never hear anybody say Black Thought's not nasty. But there are idiots out there with low, you know, IQ and low brain power that are so sweating other members of the Wu that they act like You Got's not that guy. Some, you know, and You Got's that guy, like, to the fullest. I mean, you know, I sweat, but I was going to say, a You God moment that needs to be brought to attention. And I like to, this is a moment that's powerful to me because I have a whole build on this, but not super long, but I'm just going to say this, is the Aaliyah video. The video when she passed away and they had a million people in the video. Shout out to my big brother, Smooth B, he was there. But there's a million people in the video. You know, and DMX was kind of the star of the video because it was right, you know, Romeo Must Die. Rumors Die was already out, but like it wasn't that long after that. So long story short, DMX was really like in the video, but they have all these people just like looking at the camera, sad, we miss you. And like the second to last shot, you got a million people in the video. Candles, all of that. But the second to last shot, You Got Dolo shot in a room. Throws a single red rose at the camera and they slow motion it. And then it cuts to DMX walking away with the Aaliyah jacket on. Now, this is a point I want to make. That's a rare moment. A rare moment. I want everybody to follow me on this. That's a rare moment where Hollywood was defeated by the universe of realness. And let me tell you what I mean by that, because normally, this is how Hollywood works. Normally, they would have been like, can't believe we didn't think to bring a video. I mean, a bunch of roses. Thanks, You God. Then they would have sent somebody to get some roses around the corner. They would have given DMX the rose. And you would have never seen You God in the video. That's how they do things. Mm-hmm. That's how they do things. But they didn't. God said, no, fuck that. These is the gods. That's You God. That's Lamont Hawkins right there. He needs to, the world needs to see who the fuck that man is. He's the brother that thought to bring a rose. Because you better believe if anybody else had thought to bring a rose, it would be in the video. I watched the video recently to proof check what I'm saying. Nobody in the video has a rose. It's just candles. Very end, You God, golden arms, throw the motherfucking rose, and they slow motion it. I was like, see, when I see that shit, it touches me because that shows, that's the man who wrote Black Shampoo. Maybe when that beat played, nobody else wanted to do a girl song, but You God was like, I got something for this, coconut conditioner, honey leather. So basically, he came with the rose and did that, and they allowed it to be his moment, his tribute to her, not go get the roses so we can put it in DMX and Timbaland's hand. You know what I mean? Because that's how they do things normally. Like, that's Hollywood. That's the entertainment business 1,000%. So that's a rare moment. And of course, they got to end it with DMX walking off with the jacket, because it's like, that's what they were pushing. But that's who You God is. And I never got to build with You God, but that's something I want to tell him to his face, that like brothers like me pay attention to this shit, because you know, gotta salute the queens with the love vibration, man. Fuck all that other shit, man. You know what I mean? Yeah. Niggas can say bitches ain't shit, you know, and that's fine, but it's also not fine. Sometimes it's fine to come through with the roses. Yeah. You know what I mean? You know.
Yeah. Yes. Speaking of women, shout out to Sweet Sable for one of the greatest, most heartfelt songs I ever heard in life. That's on the soundtrack. You understand what I'm saying?
Which song?
Sable.
What's it called? Yeah, I remember the name. I'm trying to remember. I haven't listened to that soundtrack in so long. I got a little rusty.
Old Time Sick.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I wanna look at the listing of that soundtrack. There was a do you got it in front of you or no?
I'll pull it up.
Yeah, pull it up so I ain't gotta lose camera at work while I pulled it up.
Sable, okay. That joint came on like an old school backyard barbecue joint in the background. Yeah, that was my joint. Man. You see it?
I can't read that. Nah.
Okay. So.
Yes.
I like that, y'all. I like that. Yeah, that. I like that, y'all. All star. Yeah. So anything, Old Time Sake, Part Time Lover, you know, that's what's playing when you walk up the stairs in the club. You see what I'm saying? And then after that goes off, I put my pen on Cold Michigan Night.
Oh, let's take a moment. Let's take a moment. And I know I'm gonna have to wrap this up in a couple minutes, but I want to take a moment to say, you're right. So let's get to the heart of the matter.
Yes.
The Above the Rim soundtrack, forget all the other songs. They don't even matter anymore. That is the song that introduced the world to Big Pimpin', with a poem that can stand next to any of Robert Frost's work. Mm-hmm. It can stand next to Pablo Neruda, Rumi, Khalil Gibran, all of that. It's, yo, that he said, and I accepted when she chose me. She chose me and I accepted. Yeah. Like your man said, and I accepted. Yes. Like, your brother, man. Yo, Big Pimpin', man.
That's this iconic staple right there, Big Pimpin', but that's not the first time, okay? That's not the first time.
That wasn't? That was the second time. You're right. That was you're right. The first time was on
What Would You Do? Come on.
You're right. What Would You Do? Yeah. But that was when that's the one. That's the one where
they named the song after him. This is Big Pimpin's Capadonna Winter
Magnum Award, Opus. Right?
Yeah,
that's right. There you go. Yeah. That's his Magnum Opus. Yo, let me tell you something. You know, you know what's
Dripping Willows
for all the Big Pimpin' fans. Pillows. Have you ever listened to, I'm going to put you up because you're a DPG lover. I'm going to put you up, okay, the sneak assassin, the secret, he's not even the sixth man off the bench. He's a starter. He's starting, but he doesn't get mentioned enough is that man, Superfly, man. Another priest. Another priest.
Superfly.
That's Priest Brooks, the legend. He's one of the he low key, like, and I say this to big him up, like he's as dope as Daz is in every way. Let's just go there. He's that guy. Like he's really, really that guy. Like he's really, really, really. And his first album is called That Whoop De Whoop. I don't know if you ever heard it. Have you ever heard it?
Yes.
Okay, beautiful. Because I was going to say that Whoop-De-Whoop is one of the all-time like underground like classics. The thing about that album was it came out right when the death row bullshit went crazy. And so what happens is it's not mixed properly. There's a lot, some of the best material, that second Dog Pound album, the real second album, Dillinger and Young Gotti and Superfly, that Wooty Woop, both of those albums sound like they were mixed by, you know, they weren't mixed right. I'm just gonna say I was looking for a funny analogy, but they sound like they were mixed. They weren't mixed right. And I mean, they sound good, but they don't sound good. When you compare to the first Dog Pound album, it doesn't have that Death Row Dre backed sound. But that first, but anyway, so Superfly has a song on there with Badass, rest in peace to him and Big Pimpin. And the song is called "Why You Wanna Act That Way." I have it in a playlist. Why you want to remember act that way? And yo, your man, fucking Big Pimpin' at the end of that song, bro.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that one to me is my second favorite appearance of him on a song after Big Pimpin'. What he says at the end is just, there's so many ways why we choose the in these ways for the way why I want to act that way. Oh my God, why I want to act that way. He has, you know, he's a fun person to impersonate, because why I want to whipping willows on satin pillows, he talks. But yo, I got another one for you. We haven't, yo, if you don't have this is something that I have to find a way to burn this on CD for you. Because this is one of the, I don't think this is on YouTube, but if it is, and rightfully so, there's a thing called, the name of it is called DPG Eulogy. Now, it's set, not DPGology, it's DPG Eulogy. It was made during the time where Dillinger and Young Gotti had a intense rivalry. It was very bad for about a year, 2 years maybe. Maybe 2 years. They squashed it. This is the past. We don't want to look back at that. We're not looking back at it. But I'm just explaining the title. It's called DPG Eulogy. And there's a lot of footage in that because it was made by Daz. So it's a very spicy, controversial DVD, to say the least. There's a lot of footage on there that is pretty amazing, is out there in the universe. I'll just put it to you like that. But nothing, Corrupt's not in it, so it's not like anything disparaging to him, like footage of him. But you know, everybody has something to say. It was at that time.
Mm-hmm.
But they squashed that. We ain't looking at that. That was just a time. That was just, you know, brothers healed. Beautiful. They acknowledge on records, hitting donuts in the streets. It's all good. Brothers, that was just, you know, families fight. That's what it is. But I'm just giving you the context of the rarity of this DVD. This is not something you're going to find on a DPG website, because they don't want this, because it's rare. But in that, there is an interview with Big Pimpin. Now, the interview with Big Pimpin, I just remembered, part of it is on YouTube. So if you do Big Pimpin interview, part of it is in it, but not the full interview. Iconic. But anyways, just had to give the God that. Shout out to Lil Pimpin', man.
I need that.
Love that, brother. You need that. There's some shit in there that's so ridiculous. It's such a moment in time. It's so ridiculous, some of that shit. And it's like they got an interview with Trady probably an hour before he went to jail. And it's like, some of that, they got RPX in there. It's incredible, man. There's some freestyles in there that are incredible. But it's priceless. I have to run you a DVD, a burn. But yeah, God, anything else to touch? Because I'm getting to that. I pretty much got it slide. But if there's anything else to touch, I'm here. Let me know. Any more above the rimmery?
Above the rimmery. We have to come back and do Murder with the K soundtrack, and we're gonna have to do Dog Food. So don't act like you don't know me, okay? Because I need that.
I need that. Above the rim, man. The basketball.
94 Cali, above the rim impact. is there an impact? Is there a game change? Is there something going on? There was a lot of things happening between 93 and 95 that we're not really privy to and unaware of. So a movie of this magnitude coming out. What that
I'll tell you this. I'll tell you this. The thing that was the statement, the thing that was really the statement was like, yo, this is a New York movie with New York niggas doing New York shit. But Death Row is so on smash that they just house the whole soundtrack. I mean, even though there's artists like, you know, Jodeci ain't like all from, you know, but it's a Death Row thing. It's like they just house the shit. And it was like that was the because this is before Pac came to Death Row. So then when Pac came to Death Row, it was like, yo, the Death Row tractor meme, the perception of it was like, yo, before he was even here, it was like Death Row was just this, like, just this was Debo and everything. Death Row was just like, this is what it is. So that was, to me, that in context was really like the statement in regards to that. Because, yeah, I mean, ultimately, Cass was playing basketball before the movie came out, and that movie wasn't particularly gangster on a level that was going to affect anybody in L.A. in any way that they was going to even flinch or do anything different. Niggas, I mean, maybe a handful of motherfuckers said, let me go buy a razor and experiment. But, like, I don't think that shit really did anything on the street level. And the basketball was already, Cass was already, you know, playing. And, I mean, maybe, you know, a couple motherfuckers, you know, play ball without a ball, but like, I don't think that really affected the streets other than just the understanding, the strength. You are now about to witness the strength of Death Row.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's what that was. So I think that's probably the only thing that really did. And it just made Pac, it also too, but for the Pac universe, it showed Pac in like the ultimate, because that's him at his most New York. Like, that's like his most New York. And this is after Poetic Justice. So we was like, damn, Pac is just, he's just, they don't, this motherfucking Pac is something else, because you couldn't get any more West Coast than he was. Shout out to Tone Loc, man. Yo, real quick before I go, man, I just say this real quick. Yo, one of my favorite things, man, when Tone Loc come to the stage, is DJ M-Walk, who's my motherfucking brother. I love M-Walk. M-Walk comes out, right? And M-Walk be like old school shit. Come, yeah, are y'all ready to make some noise for the OG? Da-da-da-da. We not coming to the stage. And he goes into like the quick little, like, you know, like the quick resume. Because they do a lot of, you know, like the kind of shows, they do a lot of those, like, corporate gigs and shit. So it's like a lot of times it's like, you know, stadium type shit. They really, so M-Walk be like, yeah, you know, the first rapper to be nominated for da 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 da, the first rapper to da 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 da, you know, the rapper, the first single, the rapper with the first single to da 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 da, and then he hits you with the actor who starred in films with Al Pacino and Tupac. But the way he says it better than that, like, I fucked it up a little bit. But it's like Al Pacino and Tupac. Like, it's like, that's the, every time he says it, I just be like, wow, that's such an ill thing to say. Like, stars in movies with Al Pacino and Tupac. I'm like, yeah. That's, because, I mean, who else can say that? Nobody. I mean, the only other person who could have said that, rest in peace, was Ricky Harris. And with that, God, I'm about to pull up to the crib any second, man.
Don't waste my motherfucking time, is what he told Ricky Harris.
Yeah, he was, yo, and Ricky Harris really held his own in the scene. Brother, it's a substance abuse problem. Where's your empathy, brother? He embodied that. Yo, I wish he would have had more lines in the scene where he was in the bedroom with Lucky's baby moms or whatever. That's Lucky. Fuck out of here, nigga. Fuck it. Like, he came out. And they put the beats on him. They gave him a non-universal beatdown.
Yeah, the worst beatdown in movie history. But the funniest
Yeah, it's like so exaggerated. Like they're like their feet are just like
yeah.
It looked like it you know what it looked like? It looked like somebody's holding them like they're dolls and right. like going like that with like some dead feet.
It's so funny.
I hope but, yo, this shit I work.
That shit is too. Yeah, that shit is priceless. But anyways, yo, God, it's always a pleasure to be a part of Do the Knowledge Radio, man. And, you know, salute the 30 years above the rim. Digital Underground's the building. Pac, who I had the blessing to meet, is in the building. You know what I mean? A shout out to everybody else and all the energies and spirits and ancestors and the gods that's in the building, man. One love, man.
Ladies and gentlemen, Digital Underground's own. California's own. LA's own. Young. Oh!
Peace. Doing the knowledge all the time, and much love. Peace.
Peace.
To the God.
Chill. Wheels are still flaming, it's Suzuki nosediving, head first into the gnosis. Zuki that held the tigers in the cages of the 80s. Isn't beauty most dire? Zodiac is whirlwind, Carby Mukti Mosiah. On his lap is a Thule, made a lavish Lazuli. Did a clap to your Uli, he the shooter, blow dryer, cold whites. Couldn't stop the cosmic Gucci snow tigers. Astrologies, Captain Soupy, boat driver. Return like an actor, but the movie most tired. Law made this part for me like barbers when they cast a roll. Smothered in exotic plant cheese above the casserole. Looking like I jacked the thunder tank, the thunder casserole. Cooking on the movie pilots. Who lit the trees like Christmas burning fiat notes? I'm using casserole. That's blowing money, couple G's, call it craft control. And two maces navigating across the maps and roads. It's too amazing, this one NASA stole. Another spell from the caster scroll. Plaque the whole classic soul records never missed. By the guy that running back control. Black and gold, fish tank in the Thames with the glassy soul. Cinematic doom with the intakes like the manifold. In the rat race, they wonder how this Cadillac. Planetary candy paint, luminary Cadillac. The world's laws can't decide who should lead us. Zodiac, God, always astrologies. Answers for the cries and the lies that they feed us. Symbols in the sky don't lie, astrologies. Take the wheel, angles of the seal, who can read us? Directions on the star map, guys, we try to free us. Zodiac, rims of the ride, the sky speakers. 12 wheel spokes, all praises, ride of Jesus. Find me cruising with the G's in the Astro Lowrider. My hot wheels lead the way, Galactic Ghost Rider. Ghost Rider wheels wrapped in gold fire. Taurus, there's Aura Gear, Smith and Wesley sniper with a telescope. Kill him the time, the Dodge Viper in the sky. Watch the clock wheels turning in the cipher. Daniel, son of man, just waxing the Jesus Chrysler. While the haters cry slurs, I'm speeding past the highest birds, absurd. And the Zugatti, followed by a fleet of wings, Ukon, Denali's probably heavenly security. My album doing angel numbers, elegance encircles me, macking to the maximum. Headdress from angel feathers, sewn by the hands on the clock, rotating. Named the net of Santa Claus from Christ. All your chains took remaining measures, train connected, drank the nectar, started to fly. A young child who saw wheels, you call stars in the sky. Listen as the spoke through the parson, the aisle where they was dry. My team reigns, it's so amazing how you dripping. Colleagues all the mics, switching lanes in the view. Wicked ladies think they ain't stuck, just wait till the glue stiffy. Talking fast cars, Arabian, bushnicking. It's that vocabulary, but language that you spit. Convertible without a cover attached. Still couldn't convert a bull, I'm too stubborn for that. Let me steer the hemisphere, rediscover the map. They dodged when I ran. Taurus can't afford this. Faith equals fiat. Z-knock, I rode a Ford tortoise to the weed spot. I see clocks, I key locks. I got the key to switch in the joy motor. Open up a glove box to send up a toy holder. The Toyota emblem over with the Saturn ring. Seen infinity and Scorpio, the padding king. I'm the vision that is seeking you saw. Of the four living creatures, have you seen it before? Like the season circulating all four with the wheel. That's four wheel drive on my automobile. Hollywood grain shifting with the magic Don Juan. Four creatures in the path of Islam. So creative, soda skater. The circles lined up like Olympic rollerbladers, doing laps in my palm. Four rings and Audi. If you ever think the God is deep, I'm probably on an Astro Safari in the astrology. Time and watches leave copper seat. Cosmic fleet speeding round the copper speaks. Blown when I drop the beat. From the top of Sugar Hill, rappers might decline. Psychic blind, I can see Honda in the Pisces sign. Mighty mind, heights we climb and leap in the flood. I can hear God's message, that's a GM plug. Four corners of the earth in the BMW. Mackin' in the Maxima, orbital vernacular, massive. Do you see aura in the Acura? Superman, I'm stronger than like 80 men. Move my arms like twisting your Mercedes Benz. Things took a turn for the best, that's when I spun the block. Turn my square to a macabre, then I bust a shot. Marathon gunner till the engine is dead. Ezekiel L smoking wheel spin in my hand. The world's laws can't decide who should lead us. Zodiac, God, always astrologer, Jesus. Answers for the cries and the lies that they feed us. Symbols in the sky don't lie, astrologer, Jesus. Take the wheel, angles of the seal, who can read us? Directions on the star map, guides who try and read us. Zodiac, rims in the ride, the sky speakers. 12 wheel spokes, all praise astrologer, Jesus.